Barns are among the oldest buildings in New England. The word barn comes from the words barley and place. It's an old English word meaning a place where one stores barley. Long ago, English farmers used their barns to store barley and other grains. They did not keep animals in their barns because winters in England were mild. In England of long ago, farmers did not own land. They paid the rent for their land by giving grains and other crops to the king or church. The grain paid as rent from many small farms was stored in very large estate barns, such as the Cressing Temple Barley Barn you see here. It is an immense structure, so big that it would take 350 of the barn you will build today to fill it up. The design of this barn, built over 800 years ago, is typical of the English barns of the time. When English farmers began to settle in New England, the barns they built were smaller copies of the great barns of their homeland. Our barns here in New England trace their ancestry and construction techniques directly from buildings like the Cressing Temple Barley Barn. We call them English barns. To build their barns, the English settlers used the same timber framing methods that had been used since medieval times. The barn's frame was made of many large pieces of wood called timbers. These timbers came from trees cut down in the forests nearby. The timbers were connected with mortise and tenon joints and secured with wooden pegs. This allowed the entire frame to be constructed without the use of nails, which were very expensive and hard to come by. English barns have hand-hewn frames. This means that the timbers were shaped by hand with axes right in the forests as the trees were cut down. Hand-hewn timbers were uneven and varied in shape and size. Each timber could join only one other that had been cut to fit just right. So the timber framer marked each joint with a Roman numeral. These were called marriage marks. Following these marks was very important so that the frame would come together exactly as the timber framer had planned. English barns were often used for threshing wheat. The threshing floor was in the center of the barn. The farmer used this area to beat harvested grain with a flail, a long stick joined to a shorter one with a piece of cord. The flail knocked the grain from the stalk. Once the grain was separated from the stalk, the farmer wanted the wind to blow through the barn, taking the dry, light stalks with it and leaving the heavier grain behind. So, the farmer put the main entrance doors along the eaves walls so the wind would blow through the shortest dimension of the barn. In fact, the term threshold is taken directly from barn history. The threshold was an actual board that held the heavier wheat that fell to the floor while the wind carried the lighter chaff away. As time went on, however, New England farmers realized that the English barn's design was not perfectly suited to the harsh New England climate. With main entrances along the eaves wall, snow and rain dumped off the roof, eroding the entranceway and soaking the farmer as he entered and left his barn. Doors on English barns typically swung outwards on hinges. This was a problem during the long New England winters when snow had to be shoveled to keep the doorways clear. To solve this problem, barn doors were mounted on rails so that, rather than swinging open, they slid from side to side. The English barn's center aisle goes across the building rather than parallel to its ridge. When a farmer wanted to enlarge his barn, he put additions on each gable end. However, these new sections were further and further away from the main entrance. Reaching all parts of the barn with a horse and wagon became more difficult, as there was little room to turn the horses around to exit. New England farmers began to rethink the design of their traditional English barn. A A clever New England farmer had the brilliant idea to put the main entry door on the gable end of the barn. A center aisle running the length of the building with another set of doors at the far end allowed the horse and wagon to exit without having to turn around. Snow and rain drained away. A farmer could easily service all parts of the building with a horse and wagon. Expansion was as easy as adding to the rear, which made the barn longer without changing its original shape. This is the barn style most of us are familiar with today. All across the country, master timber framers are still cutting and raising frames for barns and houses using the same techniques as the timber framers of long ago. Timbers are still cut with mortise and tenon joints, which are secured with wooden pegs. The frame consists of posts, beams, rafters, and braces that come together to make a structure that is strong and durable. It takes many people working together under the guidance of the master timber framer to build a timber frame. The frame comes together piece by piece, each section fitting securely into the one before. The Teamwork and Timbers program gives young people the experience of putting together a scale model of an English barn, using the same mortise and tenon joinery as builders of long ago. Piece by piece, section by section, the frame comes together, giving youngsters the tremendous satisfaction of working as a team to build a structure right out of history.